Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Can you hear okay? If you can, please sit. Oh, good. Greet you warmly and welcome you to our service of worship. We trust that you will be blessed among us and that you would know God's goodness as we celebrate together the life and love that God gives to us. We greet our live stream audience and trust that they will be blessed as they participate in this act of worship. We've gathered today. It's a Sunday where we recognize certain people. We are grateful for the opportunity to do so, and we will do in during the service. Our preparation hymn is number 67 in the United Methodist Hymnal. We, thy people, praise thee. If you are able, please stand.
Morning. Before I start, I'd just like to tell you a little story. Yesterday morning, I was walking in the mall in Appleton. I'm sure many of you have been there. And with my girlfriend. And I thought it was safe as a married man. But coming the other way, suddenly, was Pastor West. And all of a sudden, luckily my girlfriend was my wife, so I was okay. Please stand if able and join me responsibly. Sing songs of praise to the great God of heaven and earth.
Praise be to our God for goodness and grace blesses us.
Blessings abound as God shows us mercy and forgiveness.
We sing of God's bountiful blessings with songs of praise.
Please remain standing for our opening hymn.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
us in prayer. Almighty God, we sing glad songs of praise, for your bountiful blessings are with us always.
Your compassion and kindness
You may be seated. The scripture comes from Acts 16, verses 9 through 15. During the night, Paul had a vision of a man of Macedonia standing and begging him, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." After Paul had seen the vision, we got ready at once to leave for Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. From Troas, we put out to sea and sailed straight for Mesonebrace. And the next day, we went to Notapolis. From there, we traveled to Philippi, a Roman colony and the leading city of that district of Macedonia, and we stayed there several days. On the Sabbath, we went outside to the city gate to the river, where we expected to find a place for prayer. We sat down and began to speak to the woman who had gathered there. One of those listening was a woman from the city of Thyatira named Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth. She was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to respond to Paul's message. When she and the members of our household were baptized, she invited us to her home. "If you consider me a believer in the Lord," she said, "come and stay at my house." And she persuaded them, all of us.
The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today we want to recognize some folk. First, we want to recognize our high school graduates, and we have one here, Zach. Can you come up here? You don't have to sing and dance, I promise. Just come up here. So Zach is going off to college, so tell the people what you hope to do and where you're going.
I'll be attending the University of Oklahoma for sports management.
Oklahoma, that's a long way to go. You want to get out of Dodge?
Yeah.
We wish you well, Zach, and we pray God's blessing on you. We have a little gift for you to take with you. Am I doing right, Jean? Where's Jean?
You're fine.
You need to come up here and help me next, okay? God bless you, eh? Okay, Jean, we need your help. Then we want to recognize, we have another graduate, Bergen Peters. He's not here today, but we want to wish him well as also. Then our Faith Finders teachers, if you're able, would you stand? Your names are listed, or any of the Faith Finder teachers here. Out there, over there. Over here. Yes. And Jean is going to hand you a little item to recognize you and to thank you. Would you give them a round of applause? Faith Finders is our Sunday school program, and they've been trying to gather it together after the pandemic, and we are grateful to them as well. And then we have the Christian Education Committee. A number of names are listed in your bulletin. And if you are here today, would you stand? Don't be shy. We do have some here today, and we want to recognize them.
And this is also a very special year in that we have two very, very faithful Christian education workers that are taking the journey to the next step in serving our church. And they will be relinquishing their duties with the Sunday School Faith Finders program. And Jean, if you want to sneak back up here, is Julie Scheel here today?
No.
Okay. For Jean, and also for Julie, we have a gift from the Women in Faith, and a contribution has been made to mission in your name from the UMW Women in Faith group. And then in addition, from our church, we have a little something special that hopefully will help you. Now, Jean and I had children in Sunday school together many years ago, and worked on Sunday school Christmas programs and youth group programs. And my oldest kiddos are about 40, so Grandma Jean has really hung in there for quite a few years. And we'd just like you to have this to remember all the joys, the ups and downs, and just thank you for your faithfulness.
Jean, if the shoes don't fit, we'll change them. And I think it's special music. want to say to our live stream audience there, if you would like a script of the sermon, it's available online. You can look it up and download it if you so choose. Stalled only to find a new direction. Stalled only to find a new direction. It was a grunt that got my attention, told Ashley Capel, and then a small panic whine that alerted to me to any parent's nightmare. My almost two-year-old son's head was stuck in a railing at Disney World. We had come prepared. A 5-to-2 adult-to-child ratio provided plenty of hands to deal with snacks, diapers, and nap needs, and yet no one noticed that Jake was stuck. I tried to bend the wrought iron bars. Jake cried as the bars scraped his temples. I have lotion, a mom behind us called out, like remembering the old butter the head trick of getting out of the crib and stair railings. I was debating the merits of this when I realized a dad behind me had been repeating himself in a low, calm voice since the panic started. "Turn his shoulders and push him through," he said again. "The biggest part of him is already through. Just turn his shoulders and push." He gestured to his family, 7 little boys sitting quietly. Can you believe that? Sitting quietly. The guy had seen some stuck heads. We turned Jack's shoulders, and sure enough, he slipped right through. Later, I realized that we had all heard the dad repeating himself, but no one had tuned in because his voice was calm and steady. Now that Jake's head isn't stuck in the railings, it's easy to recall that God often speaks to us in a low, level voice that we need to hear. I know now to listen to that voice in others, but also in my heart. From time to time, we may find ourselves stalled, stuck, blocked, jammed, unable to move ahead. A circumstance, a condition, a crisis keeps you from taking the next steps. It could be a state of mind, an attitude, or simply a sigh that stalls you, slows your pace, and leaves you stuck in the face of stressful emotions. Unable to see a way out, you avoid making needed decisions, acting purposefully, or moving deliberately ahead. Maybe you've been avoiding a situation, only complaining about the actors who threaten you or displease you. Maybe you have lost interest, curiosity, or direction. Maybe the journey has disappointed, drained, or depleted you to the extent that you cannot muster your resources. Perhaps it's just a bad situation that you have put up with far too long. Stall suggests that those around you are moving right along while you have lost traction in your relationships, your career, your projects, your personal life, or even your faith. Going seemingly nowhere, you stall, for you can no longer muster the drive to move ahead. Disengaged, you feel overwhelmed, sidestep your duties, and head for the hills, where you would like to hide out, maybe stick your head in the sand. Mostly our discipleship to Christ, our faith, a journey, our engagement in God's mission stalls because we have become content simply to go through the motions. Your sights are not set on anything grand or glorious, anything in particular at all. The vision you once held has expired. It's no longer empowering. Your shelf life as a follower of Jesus is long past, as you barely show any deliberate interest in accompanying him. Paul, on his second missionary journey, came to Phrygia and Galatia and found that he and his companions were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word of God in Asia. It's not much of a missionary venture if God forbids speaking, preaching, and the believers from testifying. The evangelization of Europe was threatened, at risk. Hopefully God had a different plan in mind. Though stalled, Paul and his companions didn't have to wait long, for in the night he had a vision in which a man was standing and pleading with him, "Come over to Macedonia to help us." Whatever path he was on, whatever his plan or purpose, the Holy Spirit was urging him to change direction. A new path was given by the Spirit, urging him to share the good news. In New Testament days, visions seemed more common. Maybe we are less tuned in, less susceptible to God's Spirit, perhaps less presumptuous to claim a vision has been given us. Maybe we are in over our heads, stalled and stuck, but God has a plan and a purpose for us both individually and as a community of faith. It takes spiritual openness to discern God's plan. But if you focus on the voice, listen to God's leading, and turn, God will make a way. If you recognize that your faith and life have stalled, we can only turn to God and pray that the Spirit gently nudges us forward. Listen for that still small voice of God. Rather than be stuck, ask God to show you what God has in mind for you. The radio crackled as we gathered around a desk. I was barely 19 years old, not so long ago. I was barely 19 years old in my first office job. There was an inordinate amount of interest in the event that we had to break from work to hear it reported. In those days, South Africa did not have television, so we had to rely on a transistor radio. It was July 20th, 1969. Quite a bit of hype had gone into this broadcast. People gathered in different venues to witness the historic occasion. The Apollo 11 mission occurred 8 years after President John F. Kennedy announced a national goal of landing a man on the moon by the 1960s. As we know, astronauts Neil Armstrong and Edwin Buzz Aldrin became the first humans ever to land. On that day at 1:46 p.m., the lunar module Eagle, manned by Armstrong and Aldrin, separated from the command module, where Michael Collins remained. 2 hours later, the Eagle began its descent to the lunar surface, and at 4:17 p.m., the craft touched down on the southwestern edge of the Sea of Tranquility. Armstrong immediately radioed to Mission Control in Houston, Texas, a now famous message: the Eagle has landed. At 10:56, as Armstrong stepped off the ladder and planted his foot on the moon's powdery surface, he spoke his famous words that have gone down in history. That this is one small step for a man and one giant leap for mankind. The first step, a small step, changes direction and moves to a new frontier. Paul and his companions face such a new frontier. The Holy Spirit, through a dream, guides Paul and Silas to Macedonia. Come and help us. Immediately, they prepare to leave, concluding that God had called them to proclaim the gospel news to the Gentiles. While one door closed, a new door swung open, and they moved ahead, step by step. Stalled as we often are, stuck, we hold stalwart to our course, even though we lack any benefit of going in the same direction. Even in the church, we often recognize the foolishness of repeating ineffective actions. Mark Twain is credited with saying, "If you do what you've always done, you will get what you always got." And the church stands accused of repeating the same ineffective actions while expecting different results. Paul and Silas were not about to make this mistake. What small step is God asking you to take that may well be a giant leap for you? How will we dislodge ourselves from our stuck positions and cross over to something new in our faith and life? Surely God wants us to cross traditional boundaries, jump fences, change lanes, and head in new directions that serve Christ's gospel of love. It's most likely a small step that you know you should take, but you've resisted taking it recently. Some say they are too old, some too young. Some have lost interest, some are low on energy, some lack expertise, some feel biblically illiterate. Whatever your complaint, it doesn't matter that you are stalled right now, stuck in place, for your story is not over yet. It's not too late to change direction. Perhaps you need to begin a scripture reading program, a life of prayer, a service activity, generous giving, a small group for fellowship. A change will allow you to tell a new story of God working in your life and through your church community. Finding a new path, a change in direction, had Paul and his party practice simple faith. On the Sabbath day, they went outside the city gate to the river where they expected to find a place of prayer. Advancing the gospel or moving ahead in your faith and discipleship will always, always be accompanied by prayer. Prayer and discernment are spiritual processes by which God guides us, nudges us, prompts us, directs us in the way we should go. Another small step Paul takes is to find fellowship with businesswoman Lydia, a dealer in purple cloth. She's moved by Paul's message towards Christian faith as she and her family are baptized. A businesswoman, yet she becomes a convert, a humble servant of God, a follower of Christ. The change is evident as she invites Paul to stay at her house. This new direction begins small with one person, one family, and a small community, and God moves it ahead from there to the whole region. Most suspect that you need Herculean faith to move ahead and be faithful in Christ's name. But the Spirit was at work through simple faith in these participants in God's activity. Paul began with prayer. The Spirit touched Lydia to receive the good news of God's love. God's Spirit is working with you, the people of our church, and those still in need of Christ. Prayer puts you in place. It equips you to serve. It prepares hearts to receive. All we need to do is put ourselves in place for God to use us. Simple faith advances the gospel. Trusting God brings us to new beginnings, new commitments, new openness to serving as Christ leads. Maybe God is calling you to a new investment of faith, a new position in ministry, offering yourself to love and serve God. Maybe God is challenging you to a new investment of faith so that you may grow to love and serve God in this way. It will impact the life of this church. Many churches and believers have stalled. We have become content with the status quo, whereas Christ desires that we find a new direction that invigorates faith. Take the next step, a small step, and change direction. Just do it. Amen. Hymn, God of Grace, God of Glory, we remain seated. We now come to bless God with our gifts, our tithes, our offerings, as the ushers wait upon us. We invite our radio listening audience, you can make a donation online as a cost to bring you this ministry. Let us worship God with our gift. As a blessed people, we offer praise for our many gifts. Bless these gifts and us in your service, we pray. Amen. Please be seated. A time of prayer. Are there joys, concerns which you wish to share? We invite you to speak it into the microphone so the live stream audience can hear as well. Are there any joys, concerns?
I'm asking for prayers for our neighbor Ann. Saw her yesterday, and she indicated that her cancer has come back. She's going down to Zion this week to get more treatments. They're hoping to take care of it. Right now, she's in a wheelchair. The tumor is on one of the nerves, and it's making her one leg just paralyzed. So just prayers and for her to the Lord that she recovers, and prayers to the doctors that are helping her.
Thank you.
I just want to say thank you for all the prayers for healing. I appreciate that greatly. I'm on the mend. It's just going to take a little time. So thank you.
Prayers for Ken and Ruth Ann Bowles and their family. They've had lots of struggles with the passing of Ken's father, and now Ruth Ann's mom is having some very concerning health issues as she's aging and needs to be moved to a new facility. So we ask prayers for Ken and Ruth Ann, all the kids, grandkids, that they can finally get the things accomplished that need to be done as we all deal with getting ourselves aging and our loved ones aging with us.
I have a joy to report. I have a friend who had a granddaughter that was born last year, and she is just a few months old, and she had to have a cornea transplant, and it happened out in Pennsylvania, and it's doing well, and the little baby will be home in just a week or two.
We also recognize Julie Shields. She had a pacemaker placed this week, and I ask you to remember her in your prayers. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we come to you today, we know that you are a compassionate God who invites us to approach your throne of grace boldly. And so we come before you with these needs that have been named here before us, those who are celebrating and those who are experiencing hardship at this time. Grant great grace as you minister to people. Help us to be the answer to the prayer as we reach out to encourage, build up, and pray for those who are in hardship and suffering at this time. We have special blessing upon our own families. We know that we do get stuck so easily. Help us to look to God, take the next small step, and trust ourselves to what you have in store for us. Bless us as a community, as a state, as a nation. There are many who suffer. We want to associate ourselves with the people of Buffalo as they recoil from this action that has been taken that has caused the death of 10 people. We want to also today lift up the people of Ukraine and remember them before you as they struggle after the hardship that has been imposed upon them. We pray that you would bring about a cessation of hostilities, a peace, even a fragile peace. We pray that you would turn things around, that you would force back the invaders, that they may have second thoughts. And we ask, gracious God, that in this adverse circumstance, that in some mighty way, you would use it for good. And so we offer our prayer to you today in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us when we pray to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The choir. Thank you to the choir for blessing us as we are prepared to move to the conclusion of the service. A song is number 2279 in the black hymnal, The Trees of the Field. If you are able, please stand. The blessing of God is with you now and always. So go from this place and serve the Lord. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen. Thank you.